Cities are also, as Plato wrote 2,500 years ago, places that have both wealth and poverty at all points in time. How does the inequality of cities relate to the spread of disease?
Well, when we think of cities today, we may think of London or Shanghai, and we celebrate the unbelievable architecture and the big buildings and the bustle and all that. But we got to remember that there are millions and millions and millions of people living in cities in abject poverty in the barrio or beyond the urban core, whether you're in Rio or Lima. And these people are highly susceptible and suffer a terrible toll from infectious diseases. And I'll just mention quickly tuberculosis in Peru. The highly resistant TB we have today that's so hard to treat with antibiotics really festered and spread and then exploded in the poorest areas of Peru, right outside the centers of those cities. There is no sanitation. There is no clean water. There are no clinics where people can get treated. People don't have the means to even get on a bus and go to someplace where they can get help. And under those conditions, at best, you get a partial response that doesn't really cure anybody and doesn't really stop the spread of the disease and just allows it to persist and grow. So when we think about the world in general these days, we've really got to remember that every time we don't help those people bring aid and assistance and public health and epidemiology and modern medicine to those people, we're creating a reservoir for diseases that ultimately will and do affect us. So a global viewpoint that deals with the residual extreme poverty and deprivation we have in the world is absolutely critical for public health.
One way I think about this is that in the 19th century, and I think particularly waterborne diseases, when we didn't deal with things like cholera, people died on a massive scale. In the 21st century, because we have antibiotics, people die less often. And cholera epidemics are still awful, but they're not quite as deadly as they once were, precisely because we've got antibiotics, at least in some poor places like India, where they're abundant. But the downside of that is surely that we run the risk of creating terrible antibiotic-resistant disease, which pose enormous threats to everyone.
We do, and I think TB is actually a really good example. Cholera antibiotics play a lesser role. They do shorten the disease, and they can be helpful. But cholera is immediately preventable by safe water and teaching people how to treat cholera. So the primary treatment for cholera is fluid,
right?
Salt, and water. And if you look at Bangladesh, arguably an incredibly poor and deprived country with rising water due to climate change, when cholera breaks out there, mortality is actually very low. Because everybody knows through an agency, a not-for-profit called BROC, every family, every mother knows how to mix this salt solution to replenish the kid who has cholera. When cholera hit Haiti, that knowledge and infrastructure did not exist, and cholera persists to this day. And it just goes to show that where you have disruption, the hurricane, the earthquake before that, poor command and control, you don't make much progress. Where you don't have a organized program to teach people how to care for themselves, you don't make progress. I still remember a reporter from a national network sitting in a warehouse of IV fluid saying, we can't get the IV fluid to the people who need it. Well, you know, 95% of the people don't need IV fluid. They need oral rehydration therapy that costs pennies.
Right. Wonderful. Thank you.
Good.